Okay. So I don't know if you guys took a look at this, but on the board I wrote here pretty much kind of an outline that I think will be useful for you to help study for the topics in this course. This is just an idea. If you want to use a different format of an outline, you can use whatever you like. But I think this will be good for you. So if you guys can maybe just do like disease topic. For each disease topic, you're going to put either etiology, risk factors, pathogenesis, signs, symptoms, treatment. So that's pretty much the framework of each disease topic. Now, you know how the PowerPoints I have for you in the back where they have the lines on the side? Okay, so that's actually a good way to take your notes. It's a good way to take your notes, and as you see, I prep for class just like you guys would take notes, okay, in class. And so this is a nice way to kind of go through the lecture. However, I don't think this is a good idea to study from your PowerPoints for the test. And I'll tell you why. What happens sometimes when students study straight from the PowerPoints, they're just kind of reading and flipping back and forth. And unfortunately, some of those disease topics and the pathogenesis just gets kind of mixed in, okay? It blends together. And so it's really not a great thing to do to study from the PowerPoints. However, I think it's better for you guys to kind of make your own outlines, okay? So like each page, a different disease topic if you want to do that. If you can get all the information on a flashcard, that's great too. So flashcards, but try to separate each disease topic and not have a bunch of different disease topics on one page, okay? Because when you're trying to study and memorize, sometimes things do collide, okay? So I think it's better to do it that way. Now, also, for those of you who are visual learners, like myself, if you want to do like poster boards and if you want to write your outlines in different colors, I had a student one time, she did each subtopic in a different color, and that helped her memorize. You can include pictures, even if it's not a picture that I gave you, you can add in whatever picture that's going to help you. Now, in red here, you notice I have some other items. I have labs, pics, and hallmarks. So labs, we will start to incorporate lab values with some of the disease topics. We'll start that next week. And pictures, you see we have some pictures this week that we can incorporate. Hallmarks. Hallmarks is not particularly a medical term. However, it's a term that's used to distinguish something that stands out with that particular disease. Okay, so it's something that stands out with that particular disease. So say it's a special testing, or maybe there's a certain gene that is associated with that disease process. So something that stands out. And that's the category, what we call a hallmark. Hallmarks are very good to incorporate in your study guides and study from, because if you have a test question and there's a hallmark that pops up, okay, within that test question, then you know what it is, okay? You know the disease, and so it does help out a lot. So again, I think this is a nice outline, okay, that you can incorporate, and we're gonna go over actually the definition of all of these right now. Okay, so for chapter one, this chapter covers just basic terms in pathophysiology. So we're gonna go over some basic terms and I will give you examples. As you'll notice through my lecture, I give a lot of examples, and the reason why is because your test questions are actually gonna be example type questions, okay? So we're trying to move out of the what is this and what is that, but just to kind of get some scenario-based or case-based questions. Okay, so. Let me give you the definition of pathophysiology. So pathophysiology is the study of disease process. Pathophysiology is the study of disease process. So pathophysiology is the study of disease process. Now you guys tell me, where do you think disease process starts in the body? Very good, on a cellular level. Okay, so disease process begins on a cellular level. Now, you remember from anatomy how you have the levels of organization, cell to a tissue to an organ and organ system, okay, organism. So in this course, we're going to talk about how disease process starts on the cellular level, how it affects the tissue, how it affects the organ, how it affects the organ system and organism. And so by the time we take that information, especially when we go into the organ, how it's developing in the organ and organ system, this is where the patient's signs and symptoms will start to appear, okay? And so then we can move further with the information. So that's how we're gonna work it. All right, so the first topic we're gonna talk about is etiology. Etiology, they have here defined as a study of causes or reasons for phenomenon. Just to put this plain and simple, etiology is the known cause for a disease. Etiology is the known cause for a disease. Etiology is the known cause for a disease. So, we know, for example, when patients have strep throat, what is the cause for strep throat? The Streptococcus bacteria. Okay, so that we know. Streptococcus bacteria is the known cause for strep throat. Now, let's say, for example, we have primary hypertension. Do we have a known cause for primary hypertension? No, but we do have tons of risk factors, okay? So we know that there's tons of risk factors. Risk factors for hypertension can be family history, it could be a pre-existing condition of diabetes, it could be atherosclerosis, it could be a person's diet, okay? So it could be a number of things. But we can't say that, okay, well, that person, you know, going to Krispy Kreme every day is going to definitely give them hypertension because their arteries are clogged. No, we can't say that, but we know that it is a possible risk factor. Okay, so idiopathic. Idiopathic is a cause that is unknown. Okay, so this is a term that's used when we have a cause for a disease that is unknown. So, for example, we do have juvenile scoliosis. So we know that sometimes children can develop scoliosis, which is a curvature in the spine. They do not know why this develops. It just develops during that age range. And so they do put this under the category as idiopathic, okay, when you don't have a known cause. And then we have another topic here called iatrogenic. Iatrogenic. So this is a cause that results from an unintended or unwanted medical treatment. Okay, so what is that? So this is something actually that would keep you guys busy as nurses. Okay, so say for example, you have a patient that had a hernia repair, and let's say post-op, they were given Norco, some kind of pain meds, all the feel goods, okay? So with medications like Norco, what happens is it actually causes a reabsorption of water in the GI tract. And so therefore, when these patients are ready to have a bowel movement, the stool is hard. And so now this patient needs a stool softener, okay, just because of that medication. So a good example of iatrogenic is a side effect of medications, okay, a side effect of medications. We know that there is tons of different side effects of meds, okay, and you see with the commercials, okay, even the medication is supposed to take care of one thing, but then there's 15 other side effects of it, okay. So the issue here is that sometimes you guys know this, or you'll see definitely as clinicians, you have to not only give the patient a medication for whatever the existing problem is, but unfortunately you also have to give them an additional medication for maybe a side effect that may also be giving them issues, okay? And so that falls into that category. Okay, now risk factors. So I'm gonna make a list on the board because risk factors are actually broken down into two categories. So what is a risk factor? A risk factor is a factor that when present increases the likelihood of a disease. So just keep in mind that a risk factor is not a known cause, but it's just a likelihood that the disease may develop. And just keep in mind that there's probably more diseases that have more risk factors than known causes, okay? And so we do have to kind of focus on that. So for risk factors, it is broken down into modifiable and non-modifiable. Now, knowing risk factors and knowing the difference between modifiable and non-modifiable is extremely important in your patient education. So say, for example, you have a patient that you have to give them some instructions on home care or just educate them on the disease process itself and explain to them some things that can be modified and some things that cannot be modified, okay? And so that's very important. And that's one thing that I really do love about nursing is that you guys are actually the first ones to educate your patients. Just even thinking of my, you know, personal experience with some medical things, the nurse was the first one to tell me what was going on, what was happening, instructing me on my home care, instructing me on things that can be changed and things that cannot. And so this is important to kind of focus on this category. So what are some things that can be modified with health and wellness overall? Diet, very good.
Exercise.
Yes.
Smoking.
Yes, drugs, and I'm gonna also put drinking, okay? So let me just stop here for a second. So keep in mind, we know on an intake form, they, as far as lifestyle, you know, questions, they wanna know, do this individual smoke, does this individual drink, okay, the street drugs, whatever. How many packs of cigarettes they smoke and how many drinks they drink in a week, okay? Because unfortunately, those lifestyle choices have actually been linked to a number of different disease processes, not only just cancer, but even as far as smoking, other respiratory conditions, okay? So it is important to know those things. What else can be modified? Sometimes people downplay this. Stress, very good, stress. Stress is very important to understand that it is a possible risk factor for certain diseases. So you hear sometimes people say, and people think it's a joke, oh, don't stress me out, you're gonna raise my blood pressure, okay? Can you raise someone's blood pressure from stress? Maybe not one time, but yes, it is a possibility that it can happen, okay? And so when a person has emotional stress, and they do have this in chapter 2 if you want to read it at home, and I think I have that on the lesson plan. I'm not going to test you on chapter 2 next week, but however, if you want to just read up on it for your information, you can. But stress is directly linked to your nervous system and your endocrine system, which means that when a person is stressed, can this now throw off some nerve impulses throughout the body to offset things? Yes. Can it throw off endocrine organs to throw off hormones? Yes, okay. So keep in mind that stress is something that's extremely important, okay, and it can be modified. Now, I'm also gonna put something else here that sometimes people don't think about with modifiable. Pre-existing conditions. Okay, so it may look a little strange, but if we do have a patient that has a pre-existing condition that is treatable, it is still considered to be modifiable, okay, as long as there's treatment. If there's something where they can change their diet or exercise for that condition, or maybe there's a medication that they're taking, okay, to kind of alter what's going on, it is still considered modifiable. Unless we're talking about, let's say, maybe a condition or disease that's like terminal, okay, obviously that's not modifiable. But most modifiable, or I should say treatable conditions, fall under that category. Okay, so now let's make a list of some things that are non-modifiable with health and wellness.
Genetics,
very good. So genetics, and I'm also going to put here family history because that's usually what they have on an intake form, is what we want to know about your family history. Okay, so we know we can't change that. Sometimes we want to change our family, but we cannot. Okay, so that can't be changed at all. What else?
Age,
very good. So we can try to change the appearance of it, but you can't change your age. Okay. Yeah, that'll fall under genetics. Yes. So age, yes.
Sex.
Sex, very good. And sometimes people sex, gender. I didn't say gender. Sex? Okay, no, gender. So just keep in mind that there was a student that had an issue one time with a nursing instructor with, it was a test question. I don't know what the test question was, but basically she said, okay, well, what if the patient's transgender? So keep in mind that even if a patient is transgender and changes their gender, keep in mind that they still hold the genetics for the gender that they're born with. So they still hold the genetics, and so they're still predisposed to whatever conditions for that gender. So yes, that is still technically considered non-modifiable. And one last one, ethnicity. Very good. So race and ethnicity. Okay. So good. So those are all the things that are modifiable and non-modifiable. Okay. So the next topic we're going to talk about is pathogenesis. Okay, and so pathogenesis, as we know, is definitely the development of the disease from the cellular level to all the way to the organ. Now, I'm going to walk you through an example. The example's pretty long, so you don't have to write everything down, but just kind of hear me out. So I'm going to use the example of atherosclerosis / coronary artery disease. Okay, so I always use this example. It's a good one. And so I'm going to use some of the risk factors that we listed here on the board. Okay, so let's say, we'll just make a little case study. So let's say we have a 67-year-old male, let's say African-American, let's say pre-existing condition of type 2 diabetes, let's say this patient is overweight, and let's also just kind of add in that this patient is newly retired, and so he's home just enjoying his retirement and eating whatever he wants. Okay, so he's eating In-N-Out, Krispy Kreme, all the fun stuff. Okay, so he's just home relaxing. He's retired now. So what's going to happen here, let's take a snapshot into this patient's bloodstream. Okay, so let's just imagine this patient obviously would have a high lipid content. Okay, so now lipid molecules, do you think that they have a nice round circular shape like our normal cells, or do they have an abnormal shape? Okay, yes, they have an abnormal shape, which means that these lipid molecules, when they flow through the bloodstream, okay, what's going to happen is because of their irregular shape, unfortunately, they can cause an injury to the inside of the vessel wall, okay? So when these lipid molecules flow through, let's just say, for example, we have a lipid molecule that causes an injury to the endothelium of a vessel, so meaning that it cuts it, it's open. Now, you guys know, what is the body's response to an injury? Clotting. Okay, so clotting is going to happen. What else is going to happen?
Inflammation.
Inflammation, which means what type of cells would be secreted? White blood cells. Okay, so keep in mind that the body's going to go into repair mode, okay, because it has an injury. So which means that white blood cells will definitely be secreted. And so in particular, macrophages. Macrophages will come and try to eat the lipid, because remember, the immune system's very smart and knows everything that's going on, and so it knows that the lipid is the issue. So it's gonna try to eat the lipid. When macrophages try to eat the lipid, unfortunately, it will undergo an oxidation reaction and it will just blow up, okay? And so now instead of having a small little lipid molecule, now you have a foam cell, okay? So now this little lipid now turns into a bigger issue. Now to add to that, remember we said that it's repairing and it's going through the clotting. So what's going to happen, the endothelial cells will now start to regenerate, and it will regenerate over that foam cell. So now what I just explained to you is that now this is an atherosclerotic plaque in the vessel wall. Okay, so that's the pathogenesis of how that develops. Okay, so let's say that atherosclerotic plaque is in a coronary artery. What do you think is the issue here? Very good. There's going to be a blockage of blood flow to the heart muscle tissue, and in particular, a blockage of oxygenated blood flow to the heart, which means what type of sign or symptom do you think your patient is going to have? Before that, chest pain. Very good. Chest pain. Okay. And then later on, they'll have shortness of breath. But it'll be immediately chest pain. Okay. The reason why they have chest pain, angina, the reason why patients have angina is because there's an immediate decrease in oxygenated blood flow to the cardiac muscle tissue, okay? Not to say that they're having a heart attack right at that moment, but it's just because it's a diminished blood flow, okay, to the tissue that's causing that pain. Okay, all right, so that's that. Now, two things I wanted to say with that example. So you know how I said that it oxidizes? So one thing that you should know, and if you want to write this down, when disease process starts at a cellular level, it will usually have an oxidation reaction. So when disease process starts at the cellular level, it will usually start with an oxidation reaction. And so that's usually one of the things that can happen, okay, oxidation reaction. And so we're gonna go over some other cell injuries later, but oxidation is one. And another thing I wanna point out to you guys is that the immune system is involved in every disease process. Okay, the immune system is involved in every disease process. Now, whether the immune system is going to take care of it completely or not, that doesn't matter, but I do want you to know that the immune system is involved in every single disease process. And so no matter what's going on, the immune system will try to tackle it, okay? And even sometimes, and I'll show you later, unfortunately, the immune system sometimes can cause the disease process to come out even further, okay? So we'll talk about that later. Okay, so clinical manifestations. This is another category of where we have what are called our signs and symptoms, okay? So there is a difference between a sign and a symptom, even though you may hear those terms interchangeably, but it is a difference between the two. So a symptom is what we call the subjective feeling of the abnormality in the body. So subjective meaning the subject, so, or what the patient feels, okay? So a better way to explain it is a symptom is what the patient feels. So the patient says, I feel cramping, or I feel tingling, or I feel burning sensation, or whatever's going on, or I feel nauseous. That's what a symptom is. A sign is an objective or an observed feeling. Objective or an observed manifestation of the disease. So what you as a clinician observe, okay? So say with your patient, you observe edema, or you observe redness, or you observe that they have a productive cough, or whatever the case may be. So that would be a sign. And another good thing to add into this, if you want to write down, a sign is anything that's measurable. Okay, so if you can measure it, that's included with a sign. And it's objective. Okay. Now a syndrome is a set of signs and symptoms not yet to determine a delineated disease. The best example I can give you for this is AIDS. AIDS, we know, is titled acquired immunodeficiency syndrome, which means by the time a patient has full-blown AIDS, they have a number of different diseases happening all at one time, okay? So it's hard to say, okay, well, that particular symptom is from the Kaposi sarcoma or the toxoplasmosis or whatever type of infection they have going on. But because it's so many things going on at one time, it's hard to distinguish which one it is. So that's considered a syndrome, okay? Let me just show you this really quickly. This is an example of a soap note. Now, a soap note is used pretty much with a lot of different medical professionals. I know you guys as nurses use the SBAR format, which I will give you some examples with that later on during the term. And I believe they also now, in nursing simulation, I think they're including now the iSBAR format, okay, to identify the patient and then go into the report. Okay, so in any event, I just wanna show you this because I wanna show you how in sign and symptom, the definition subjective and objective, how that applies to a progress note, okay? So if you have to make a progress note on a patient and just write down whatever information, the S is going to be the subjective portion. So S stands for subjective. And for the subjective portion, this is where you're going to put patient's chief complaint. They have listed here history of present illness, even medical history. Okay, so whatever the patient is presently feeling at that time, and even whatever prior issues that they may have had, state there. Okay, always for objective. And in this portion, I know it's very tiny, that's why I'm reading it to you. They have in here vitals for the objective portion. They also have, along with vitals, full physical assessment, clinical exam, okay? And also even here, radiology findings. So anything that is tested or measured, okay, with that patient goes into the objective portion. Assessment, A for assessment.
Thank you.
For the assessment portion, I kind of look at this like a problem list. Okay, so now that we have information of what the patient is saying that is going on with them, and now we have done our vitals and other special testing to see what has occurred, now you can come up with an actual, we don't want to say diagnosis or problem list, okay? So they have here the patient's asthmatic, they're a smoker, they may have some other issues going on here, which I can't read because this is a little blurry, but you basically make your problem list. And then the plan here is going, P is for plan, and your plan should actually correlate with everything in your assessment. So all the problems that you have on the assessment, your plan should address everything in the assessment. So whatever the recommendations are. So I just wanted to show you this because it is nice to know the SOAP format, even though I know you guys may not directly use this particular format in nursing, but it is nice to see because even physical therapists use it, you know, other health professionals do use this format, so it is good to know. Okay. So stages and clinical course, you guys may have gone over these terms in micro, so I'll just kind of breeze through this really quickly. Latent period, we know that anytime we have a latent period of a disease, it's the time between exposure of tissue and injurious agents to the first appearance of signs and symptoms. But keep in mind, you guys know this, when we have a latent period of a disease process, usually signs and symptoms are not present, okay, or they really don't show themselves. So let's say, for example, you go on a plane. Planes, we know, are always crowded and confined, okay? And so let's say you're sitting next to someone that has a flu, okay? And they're sneezing and coughing all over the place, and we know sometimes people do not cover their mouths, okay? So let's say you get a whiff of that, okay? So let's say that now you are exposed, okay, to whatever it is that person has going on with them, and let's say now the disease process is starting to develop in your body. During the latent period, what will happen is you may not have signs or symptoms in the beginning, or let's say if you do, maybe you'll start off with a little tickle in your throat, maybe a little postnasal drip, but by the time you get to the prodromal period, which is now the disease is pretty much established and now you're gonna have the signs and symptoms really present itself, let's say that that tickle in your throat now turns into a cough, and let's say that postnasal drip now turns into congestion, okay? So now we have the full disease process developing, okay, there. All right, so subclinical stage is a term for where the patient functions normally and the disease process are well established. So let's say, for example, any one of us in here could, you know, have hypertension, thyroid disease, ulcerative colitis, whatever it may be. And so let's say that, when we are diagnosed with certain diseases, when we talk about the subclinical stage, it means that the patient is still able to have a decent quality of life, okay? So you can still go to school, you can still work, you can still function, okay? But you still have that disease process well established. Now, acute and clinical course, and chronic clinical course, with an acute clinical course, it means that it's short-lived and may have severe manifestations. So it is very important to know the difference between acute and chronic. So when you have an acute disease process, I do want you guys to write down this because it's not written down here for you. When you have an acute disease process progresses very fast. It goes very fast with acute. So with an acute disease process, the disease process progresses very fast. It progresses very fast, which is the reason why it's short-lived, because it goes very fast, and it does have maybe more severe manifestations. Okay, so next week we're going to do a chapter on leukemias and lymphomas, and you'll notice that acute leukemias are actually way more aggressive than chronic leukemias, okay, and it's because the disease process just is that fast. Chronic clinical course. When you have a chronic disease process, it actually takes longer. It takes maybe months, maybe years for it to develop. But I don't want you to think that it's actually better, okay? So say for example, we know that from 9/11 that there was a number of the workers that helped out with what happened 9/11 and they developed occupational lung diseases. So keep in mind when patients develop occupational lung diseases, unfortunately, it takes almost, maybe sometimes up to 10 years for signs and symptoms to appear, which means that all that time, that disease process has been developing. So even by the time they're fully diagnosed with it, it's irreversible, okay, at that stage. So just keep in mind that having a chronic clinical course is not always better. Now, can an acute lead to a chronic? Yes, okay, definitely. So say, for example, if someone is working on the roof, okay, they fall off the ladder, and if that person falls off the ladder, has a fracture, okay, to the bone or the joint area, is it a possibility that this patient could maybe have long-term degeneration because of that fracture? Yes, okay, and so that will be the chronic. Okay, so fracture is acute, but degeneration is chronic. Okay, so exacerbation and remission. Exacerbation is an increase in signs and symptoms. Remission is a decrease, okay? So, a good example here for both actually would be Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis. Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis are actually bowel conditions, okay, where these patients can sometimes go into exacerbations and remissions, okay? So sometimes they can have bouts of diarrhea and abdominal cramping, and then sometimes they can go into remissions where they have no signs and symptoms at all, okay, for weeks, months, or whatever. So that's a good example of that. Now, in your book, they talk about remission, and they say that if a patient goes into remission past 5 years, that patient is said to be cured, okay? However, we know we have to be very careful with saying the word cured, especially when we talk about cancer, okay? So we know that patients that have cancer can go into remission 5, 10, 15, even 20 years, okay? And here we go again with another round. So the proper term for patients that have, even though people say cured and they use that term loosely, but the proper definition really for cancer is to have a patient go into what they call complete remission. Or long-term remission. So that's the proper terminology you use. And we'll talk about that a little more with cancers next week. Covalence is the stage of recovery after disease, injury, or surgical procedure. So we can kind of, a good example for that is post-op. So when patients have a surgery and then post-op, they're just have any type of home care or medication, that will be that stage. Sequela is a subsequent pathological condition resulting from an acute illness. So kind of the same thing as how I said an acute can fall into a chronic, so that patient that fell off of the ladder had a fracture, but they can now lead to a pathological condition of degeneration, okay, because of that issue. Okay, individual factors. Okay, so this one is very important to know. Why? When we talk about individual factors, this goes over some of the things that you would probably see on an intake form, okay? So before you guys even touch your patients, okay, in most cases, you're gonna look at some sort of paperwork. Maybe it's an intake form, maybe it's some previous notes, okay, from the previous nurse that was on duty, and just kind of looking at what information, okay, that you have for that patient. So let's go into this. And with individual factors, it is good to go over these topics because sometimes, especially if it's a new patient, just kind of having a working diagnosis going on in your head or possible recommendations or management that should be given, okay? So the first thing we have here is cultural considerations. So sometimes looking at a patient's cultural background is important. Why? Because as they say here, each culture defines health and wellness according to their own experience. And so that's really the highlight of what you guys should be getting from cultural pluralism. The course that you guys, are you taking it now or some of you taking it already? Okay. So if you're taking that course, the big picture is to see not only, okay, learning about different cultures, yes, it's great, but how does each culture define health and wellness and how would they adapt to different health situations? So we know, for example, that some cultures actually focus more on homeopathic medicine, okay, where they may use herbal remedies or they may use acupuncture. And sometimes it is good to have some knowledge of that because sometimes your patients may come to you and they have already pre-treated the situation, okay, with something. We know even we can add in here religion. So we know that there are certain religious groups that have to have bloodless surgeries. Also, it is good to also add in ethnic or cultural, I should say not cultural, but ethnic related genetic disorders, okay, such as sickle cell anemia, we know, is definitely prominent in people of African-American descent and Mediterranean descent. Tay-Sachs disease is common amongst people of Jewish descent. Okay, so kind of knowing those genetic disorders and what ethnicities they're related to is important. So age. So age and biological factors. Okay, so it's good to have knowledge of that, which means sometimes certain things that happen to us at one age, okay, as we get older, is different when we're young. Okay, so we know what happens when we get older. So what happens when we age? One thing. Okay, so the immune system? Yes. I'm sorry.
Sorry, like more mutations.
We can have more mutations with the cells, so it is a possibility that can put a risk, even saying that it can even put a higher risk for cancer. So that is a possibility, yes, okay, as we get older. That's why when we look at most cancers, they do develop around, they can start to develop around certain ages because of that. Very good. What else? What are some other things that happens as we age? Yes, we do take a little longer to heal because our immune systems do weaken. Okay, as we age, and if any of you who are LVNs, okay, or work in the medical field and work with geriatrics, you know that geriatrics are very common with getting infections, okay, especially UTIs and things like that, that because of the immune system, unfortunately. Yes?
Chemical changes with age.
Yes. Chemical changes, definitely hormones, we know start to decline, especially with not only females, but males as well, okay. So females, we know, have a decline in estrogen, which leads us a little more closer, okay, to menopause. Men, when they have a decline in testosterone, they do believe that it's a little more linked to BPH, okay? So, and they haven't titled yet as a condition, but they are doing research and they're coming out with a name for it, andropause, for men. But it's not a complete, you know, diagnosis yet, but they're working on that. And so, yes, the levels do change. What are some other things that happen?
Age-related, like osteoporosis?
Yes, bone weakens, skin, we wrinkle, everything goes south, okay? We know that. So, we lose collagen, okay? And keep in mind that collagen is not only in the skin, okay? Collagen makes up other parts of our body as well in certain organs, okay? And in one particular thing, collagen actually makes up our blood vessels. Sometimes people tend to forget that. Those of you who work with geriatric patients, what do you see commonly on their skin?
Bruises.
Okay. And so they bruise very easily because there's a lack of collagen and their blood vessels are very thin. So we don't want to look at that patient and say, okay, well, let's run a blood coagulation testing and thinking there's some sort of blood coagulation issue or another issue going on. But just know that that may be part of their aging process, okay? Now, if you see unexplained bruising on a child, is that normal?
No.
No, not at all. That can be a number of things. It can be cancer, it can be a blood coagulation issue, it can be child abuse, okay? So it can be a number of different things. So that's a very good example to kind of look at how things change, okay, as we age. Okay, gender differences. So we know there's definitely a gender difference with males and females as far as hormones and the reproductive system. But what else are some different things in males that are different than females?
They're more likely to get diseases and die from them.
Yes, they are. Yes. Men tend to be more prone to diseases because of their genetics, okay? But also men, as from physiology, you guys may have learned that they have more muscle mass than females, okay? And females, unfortunately, we have more areas of fat, okay? Which means that you should not give a male patient the same diet as a female patient, okay? Because females, we distribute fat differently, so diet and exercise plan should be different. Also, body volume, overall. Men tend to overall have more body volume than females, which means that they have more blood volume as well, okay? Which is something to also take into consideration if, you know, someone has to have a blood transfusion or something like that. Now, situational differences. I always use myself for this example because I can't think of anything else, so I'll just continue using it. So, I'm from New Jersey. I don't know if you heard the accent, but that's where I'm from. So, I moved here to California about 4 years now, almost 5 years ago, and so in New Jersey, we have a lot of snow and just crazy weather. And so when I moved here, my first ski trip was when I moved to California. So I know that sounds crazy, but that's the first time I went skiing. So I went to Mammoth to snowboard. I didn't ski. I actually snowboarded in Mammoth. And so for those of you who ski and snowboard probably know Mammoth is for the experience. And I had no business being there because I wasn't ready. And so the instructor took us on a run that, and I don't know how to stop. And so if anyone snowboards, just maybe you guys can still help me on how to stop. I don't know how to
just
stop.
Just don't do it.
Just don't do it. I want to try it again, but I'm just like, I don't know. So.
Bunny hills.
The hills.
Bunny hills.
Bunny hills. Yeah, just do that. Okay. Yeah, he took us. I was like, whoa, are we ready? You know, he jumped off and we went going. Actually, it was me and Dr. Williams. She was doing okay. She was doing okay. I was about to go through the little orange fence, okay? So, yeah, I was having issues. Now, that was also my first time going into that type of elevation, okay? So I had elevation sickness really bad, okay? So when the body goes into that type of elevation, you guys tell me, what is happening to the cardiovascular system? Harder to breathe, it's working harder, okay? So what happened to me, my heart obviously was in extreme palpitations. It felt like it was going to jump out of my throat. The heart has to contract very fast. Why? Because it needs to push out more blood. And the reason why is because we need to kick out more red blood cells in that type of elevation so we can increase the oxygen carrying capacity. And also they kept telling us to drink fluids, drink more water. And you guys know when you give your patients IV fluids, fluids help, you know, for reasons, obviously, if they're depleted of electrolytes, but fluids also help for blood circulation and blood flow. Mm-hmm. And so that's why they kept telling us to drink fluids. It didn't really help me. I was just ready to go home. even though the trip was fun, but it was just too much, the elevation sickness. And so just keep in mind that the reason why I told that story is because the body will adapt to certain situations. And so the cardiovascular system will kick in to try to, you know, counteract that elevation and increase the oxygen to a certain point. Okay. Now, time variations. Time variations, we have here day to night. Okay, so a good example is blood pressure. Okay, so what happens with blood pressure when we first wake up in the morning? It should be low. Okay, so when you first wake up, when you first get out the bed, okay, it should be low. Now, as you move about your day, it should raise, okay, and then as you wind down at night, hopefully it should lower a little bit, okay? So blood pressure does fluctuate over, you know, the time of the day, which is important to know because if you are instructing your patients to take their blood pressure at home to make sure they're taking it the same time each day, okay, because it will change. Okay, so for epidemiology, just a few topics here. We did have a course in epidemiology. They took it out of the program. However, we'll just cover these terms here, and I do have some examples. Okay, so epidemiology is the study of patterns of disease involving populations. So basically, how diseases affect everyone on a global aspect. Now, endemic is a disease that's native to the local region. And so a good example we can have for this one is malaria. Okay, so we know that malaria is only present in certain parts of Africa. Okay. Epidemic is spread to many people at the same time. Okay, and so the latest epidemic that is out was the Zika virus. Okay, that's been the latest epidemic. And the pandemic disease is spread to large geographic regions. Okay, and so the most common pandemic disease, believe it or not, is actually the cold or flu virus. That's the most common. The most deadliest pandemic disease is AIDS and Ebola. Okay. So that's that. Okay. Now, some more factors that can affect diseases. Okay. Most of these we already went over, so let me just go over socioeconomic factors and lifestyle considerations. Okay, so again, some more things that you would look at on an intake form. So looking at a patient's socioeconomic background is important. Okay, why? Because you want to make sure, does this patient have the resources that they need to get proper medication or proper nutrition or food that they need to have, or even home care. So you guys may work with, or some of you already work with, some patients that are transients. Or they, you know, that's the new term now instead of saying homeless. Okay, we have to say transients. Because if you have a patient that is a transient, can they, you know, do everything in the recommendations in home care? Okay, do they have the facility to get proper water or whatever it is that they need? So it is important to take a look at that. Lifestyle considerations. Okay, so we already know smoking, drinking, okay, drug activity, and also sexual exposure. Okay, and so the very last thing we're going to cover here is levels of prevention. Primary is altering susceptibility and reducing exposure to susceptible persons. Okay, so what does that mean? So a very good example for that would be education. Okay, as long as you guys can educate your patients on things that they can do to reduce the susceptibility of whatever it is, okay, that's gonna be helpful. So say for example, you have a patient that may have to go home with a catheter, okay, and you would have to educate them or instruct them on how to clean the area. Okay, because you want them to reduce the susceptibility of infection. Because when patients do have catheters, we know that they can definitely get infections in that area. Also, another good example, vaccinations, okay, or immunizations. So keep in mind when you guys, and you'll be doing this this term, getting ready for core, okay, and clinicals. You'll have fun going to the doctor and getting your titers and getting everything done. To get prepared. And so keep in mind that when you have immunizations, it's not really just to only protect you and make sure you don't get sick, but it also protects everyone else. Okay, and so it is important part of prevention. Secondary is early detection, screening, and management of a disease. So this can be any type of routine, annual physical, routine blood work, any type of testing that should be done at a certain age, like a prostate exam or colonoscopy, things like that. Even follow-up care, okay, can go in that. So any type of care or treatment. And then tertiary, this is going to be rehabilitation and supportive care. So when we get to tertiary, this also incorporates some treatment, but what they have here for rehab, when we think of rehab, people automatically go to OT and PT. So yes, therapy, those types of therapies are good for, you know, those situations. However, rehabilitation can also include aspects of mental health. So I don't know if you guys know, but mental health nursing is in demand. I think it's always been. Usually when I talk to students in the hallway that go through mental health clinicals, they either love it or hate it. There's no in between. So it takes a special person to really go into mental health nursing. But mental health nursing definitely is included in that component. Okay, so it is also part of a form of treatment for certain situations. Even with supportive care, they do have certain diseases such as even Crohn's disease or ulcerative colitis. These patients do have support groups, okay, where they can get together and talk about their situation. So that is anything that's going to help bring that patient back to normal function. We can even include here alternative therapy, alternative medicine, I should say. So we know that sometimes they even have it now in cancer centers that patients can have massage therapy, acupuncture to help with their pain management. So those things can also be incorporated, okay, to help them get back to normal. Mm-hmm. All right, I'm done. Okay, let's take another quick break. I think I've fallen a little behind, but we'll be okay. This chapter focuses on cell injury. So remember that we discussed that the disease process starts at the cellular level. Okay, so with this chapter, we're going to talk about all the different types of injuries that can happen to the cell. Okay, and then we'll move on from there. So the first topic we're going to talk about is reversible cell injury. So just to give you a little bit of an idea, when you're making your outlines for this chapter, it's probably best to make two columns, okay? One that has reversible cell injury and the other column reversible cell injury, because that'll be a good way to make your outlines, okay? So most of the topics we're gonna talk about here is reversible cell injury, and then I'll let you know when it starts for irreversible, okay? So for reversible cell injury, the first type we have is hydropic swelling. And basically, this is when the cell actually fills up with water, okay? You guys may have touched on this a little bit in physiology, maybe, with water entering the cell and the cell getting very large. And so they say that this is the first manifestation of most forms of reversible cell injury. Now, you're probably wondering, well, why does the cell fill up with water in the first place? Well, what happens here is that, remember, we have ion channels on the cell membrane, okay? Mm-hmm. And in particular for this situation, the issue is the sodium potassium pumps. So the sodium potassium pumps actually malfunction, which means that excess sodium will actually now come into the cell. So if you have excess sodium in the cell, what do you think is the next thing to follow?
Water.
Water. Very good. Okay, so when water follows, this is what's going to make it larger. Now, why are the pumps malfunctioning in the first place? The reason why is because usually there's a lack of ATP. Okay, so remember, ATP is what drives these ion pumps. And so if we don't have enough ATP, which is cellular energy, to drive these pumps on the cell membrane, the cell is not going to function properly. Okay, and so that's basically what it is. And just to refresh your memory,
ATP, you know how it's formed, okay, with glucose, transforming with glycolysis, Krebs cycle, electron transport chain. Okay, I know you wanted to forget all that. But keep in mind, those processes are very important, because if we don't have those processes, we don't have ATP, which means if we don't have enough ATP, cells won't be able to function, and that will be the start of disease process, okay? Okay, so this picture here, right? Now, in anatomy, you guys took a look at a lot of different histology slides. You probably wonder why, okay? Your histology will come back to haunt you in this class, okay? So we will look at a number of pathology slides, okay? So you guys took a look at, the normal. Here we're going to look at abnormal, okay? So this week we just have some pictures, but next week we're going to have some blood slides of leukemias, okay, that we'll take a look at. So this is just an example to show you. You're not responsible for this picture. You're only responsible for the pictures that I gave you in the handout, okay? But just to refresh your memory, what type of epithelial cell is this here? Very good, simple cuboidal, okay? And when I used to teach anatomy, I would tell students, take a look at the nucleus. If the nucleus is nice and round, okay, that's cuboidal. If it looks a little squish, that's squamous, and we know columnar to be larger, okay? So look at the nucleus. Sometimes you really can't tell from the shape of the cell membrane, but really look at the nucleus, okay? And to further pick your brain, do you guys remember what tissue type this is or what organ? I think I heard it. Kidney. Yes, this is the kidney. Very good. Okay. Kidney tubules. Okay. I know that was stretching. I know. But kidney tubules. Okay. And so this is the kidney tissue. Okay. And so keep in mind, from anatomy, you guys learned that the function of cuboidal cells are for secretion, excretion, absorption, things like that, which is actually what happens at the kidney level. Okay. And so we do have that type of epithelium there. So very good. Now, what you're looking at here on this side, obviously, is abnormal. And these are actually the simple cuboidal cells that are swollen and filled with water. Okay? And so much to the point that the kidney tubules are distorted. Okay? So that's just an example of what it will look like on the slide. Okay? So, hydrophic swelling continued. Now, when we think of this water entering in the cell, yes, it is filling up the cell and filling up the area of the cytoplasm, but I want you guys to also understand that the water will also fill up in the organelles as well. So it fills up in the mitochondria, the endoplasmic reticulum, everything. Now, another piece to this is that if we have the cells getting large, the tissue is going to get larger. And if the tissue gets larger, the organ is going to get larger. Okay? And so now we have a term for that. And the term for organ enlargement is megaly. So just to give you some examples, and you guys probably heard of this before, cardiomegaly, which is enlargement of the heart. We have splenomegaly, enlargement of the spleen, megaly. Hepatomegaly. I'm writing so fast, I can't spell. I hate when your brain works faster than when you're writing. Okay. So cardiomegaly, splenomegaly, hepatomegaly. Okay, so splenomegaly, enlargement of the spleen, hepatomegaly, enlargement of the liver. Okay, yes.
Just for reference, let's shrink the medical term.
For shrinkage? Atrophy. We're going to go over that in the next few slides. Okay, so we're going to go over atrophy and hypertrophy. Now, sometimes hypertrophy and megaly, they use them sort of interchangeably sometimes, so depending on how it's being used, I should say. But megaly is usually talking about the organ,
Whereas sometimes if you use the term hypertrophy, it's more so localized to the tissue or the cell. So they kind of use that terminology more so for that. Yes?
The megaly is generalized, not specifically for accumulation of water, or is it implying accumulation of water?
So they're implying here that the accumulation of water is just one type of reversible cell injury where the water accumulates and makes the cell larger. What they're saying here is that in order for a megaly to occur in an organ, it's going to start at the cellular level. So the cell is going to get larger, then the tissue, then the organ.
So megaly, you're saying, just means swelling?
Yes. It's a generalized swelling, yes. Megaly is a generalized swelling of the cells and organs that makes the whole organ larger. And it increases the size and weight. Okay. And so that term megaly, again, is used more so looking at the organ itself. Okay, now we also have within the cell intracellular accumulations, okay? So sometimes we can have an excess of accumulations of things inside the cell that should not be there, okay? So this can be due to cell injury due to toxicity or immune response. So let's say, for example, there's bacteria that may get inside the cell, okay? And if that happens, that bacteria is just going to take up cellular space and obviously cause an issue. Okay. Also, we can have here an excessive amount of normal intracellular substance. So let's say, for example, ribosomes. Ribosomes we know are needed, okay, to make proteins for the cell. But let's say, for example, that we have too much ribosomes or too many proteins that are being produced. So that's going to take up intracellular space. Okay. Does that make sense? So we also have things that can accumulate, an accumulation of abnormal substances secondary to faulty metabolism, okay? So for example, we know that the endoplasmic reticulum is supposed to transport carbohydrates, okay? Now let's say, for example, if the endoplasmic reticulum is not doing its job and carbohydrates are just sitting there, that's gonna also take up space. And also, if we have accumulation of particles that cannot or unable to degrade. So let's say if our lysosomes are not working properly. We know lysosomes have enzymatic activity to digest and get rid of things. If they're not working, then we're going to have an accumulation of waste just sitting there. Okay. So any type of accumulation that can occur. Now, they say the liver is a common site for accumulation, and one of the reasons why is because the liver actually has a lot of different functions, okay? And so let's go through that. Let's use this as an example. What are some examples, or I should say, what are some functions of the liver that you guys remember from anatomy or physiology? Okay, very good. Detoxification. Okay, so we know that the liver is our main and only really detoxification organ. Okay, very, very important. And so what it means is that the liver will take toxic substance and convert it to a non-toxic substance. So now we can have things flow very nicely in the bloodstream and we can function normally, okay, in homeostasis. And so when we think about the liver and detoxification, usually people think of, you know, alcohol. So yes, if you go to happy hour, get too happy, okay, and you consume a lot of alcohol. What's going to happen? Yes, the liver will take all of that alcohol and convert it to a non-toxic substance. Same situation with medications. Okay, so we know that sometimes with pharmaceutical meds, patients can take things and the liver actually has to convert that toxin, okay, to something else. What are some other functions of the liver that we know?
Filter.
It can filter, not so much filter, but it actually helps with something else with the blood. Kidneys filter a little more than the liver, but it does something else with the blood. It secretes blood coagulation factors, clotting factors. Remember, the liver secretes clotting factors. Very important to know and understand that. Why? If you ever have a patient with liver disease, sometimes they can have issues with bleeding, okay, because if they have, their liver is damaged, and even alcoholism, they can actually have excessive bleeding because they're not able to make the factors that they need. Okay, so just know that the liver makes blood coagulation factors.
The liver secretes what?
Bile.
Very good. Okay, so remember the liver secretes bile. And the reason why it secretes bile is to help, very good, yes, with fat metabolism. Okay, so keep in mind that bile mixes in with the fat, breaks it down into little pieces, so we can digest it. So keep in mind that the liver helps with fat metabolism. And one last thing about the liver, sometimes people forget, it's a good storage for, oh yes, I'm sorry, yes, it does that too, two more, yes. So it helps with gluconeogenesis. The liver helps convert into new glucose when needed, okay? And you guys remember that from physiology, gluconeogenesis. And one last thing, it stores, not hormones, vitamins. The liver is a very good storage for vitamins. And those of you who do eat animal livers, okay, some people eat chicken livers and beef livers, know that it is actually a really good source of vitamins, okay? So, what's the purpose of saying all that? Okay, let's say you have a patient that is suffering from alcoholism. Okay, have you guys ever heard of the term fatty liver? Mm-hmm. Yes, okay. So what happens here, when the patient has alcohol abuse and they now are diagnosed with fatty liver, what's happening with that is when they develop fatty liver, it means that the fat metabolism has taken a back burner. Okay, and so the liver is so focused on detoxification because this alcohol is just daily. So that's its only focus, is that function. So all the other functions take a back burner, which means that now they're going to accumulate fat in the liver. And not only that, they can also have bleeding issues and vitamin storage issues and everything else, okay, because of that. So let me just show you this picture really quickly, since I was talking about fatty liver. This is a pathology slide of fatty liver. So here is normal. This is a normal liver slide. This is a person that has fatty liver. So normally what happens, the liver tissue has vacuoles, okay? And vacuoles are just temporary storage. When nothing is in there, it's flat, you don't see anything, okay? Just maybe those little spaces there. Now, when this person that has fatty liver, the vacuoles are actually going to fill up with fat, and they're very large circles, okay, as you can see. So that's just an example of that. Okay. Now, going back to this one. So these are some more reversible cell injury examples. And the examples that I will give you for each one, I'll explain. Some of the examples that I may give you may not be reversible, but I don't want to confuse you. But these items are still considered reversible cell injury. Okay. So we talked about fatty liver. We know that. Now let's talk about protein mutation. So we know that each cell during cell reproduction has to go through mitosis and an interphase. You guys remember that interphase had different checkpoints, okay, to move on. And so remember that during interphase, we have to make sure we're ready to move on to the next part, okay, during those checkpoints. But let's say, for example, maybe something occurred during interphase that wasn't right and the cell still moved on. So what happens here, you're going to have a problem with that particular cell. Maybe there was an issue with the protein folding and transport, now leading into an abnormal cell. And so there's an accumulation of things that can occur there. Okay, so that is a type of reversible cell injury. However, let me give you a real-world example that can probably be what is irreversible. Genetic disorders. So that's a very good example, too, sometimes of genetic disorders. We know that there's some sort of issue that occurs during mitosis, okay, with the genes that can now lead into this abnormality. Same thing also with cancer, okay? Cancer, we know, is an altered gene expression, and so it's just a matter of it developing. The next thing we have here, enzymes. We know that we need enzymes to bring a substrate to a product. You guys know that from chemistry. And here, what will happen if you don't have an enzyme, this is going to now just have an accumulation of that particular substance just sitting there, okay? Very good example I can use for this is patients that are lactose intolerant, okay? Patients that are truly lactose intolerant lack the enzyme lactase, which means that if they have any dairy products that they're intaking, that lactose will just sit there in the GI wall. Okay, it'll just sit just like that in the cell. It'll just sit there in the wall. Now, if a patient that has lactose just sitting in the GI wall, what type of signs or symptoms do you think they're going to have?
Bloating.
Bloating, very good, because it's just sitting there.
Cramping.
Gas. Okay. And what happens is this. The reason why, and we'll talk about this when we get to GI, and we'll talk about how we develop gas, if you're interested in that. And so the reason why patients that are lactose intolerant are gassy is because even though the body doesn't have an enzyme to break that particular product down, it actually will try to break it down chemically. So it'll turn into a gaseous state, okay? So that's why it's, you know, people that are lactose intolerant and they don't take their lactate pill, they will be very gassy, okay? Because the body will try to break it down. And it'll also cause them to have maybe diarrhea because the body's trying to push it out and get rid of it. So it'll increase peristalsis, okay, so they can get rid of that substance. All right, so that's that. Ingestion of indigestible materials. So this particular one, let's say, and I'm going to show you a picture. Let's say we have someone that inhales, let's say asbestos, okay, they're working around that type of environment. And do we have an enzyme to break down asbestos? No. Okay, so now this particular product is just kind of stuck there, okay, in the tissue, in the cells. And so one thing I want you to know is that the immune system will try to get rid of it, okay, and so depending on the amount, it may be reversible, but then there's cases where it's not, okay. So let me show you this picture. And I really need to change this title. I don't want to confuse you. But so this is a normal lung. This is a lung. Actually, I'll write it on the board. This is a person that has silicone lung. So this person, probably from their work environment, okay, inhaling silica. And so when you look at this lung tissue, you see all that bluish, sort of blackish area? That is all the area that the silica material has infiltrated the lung tissue. Please understand that this did not happen overnight, okay? So that probably was years and years of that person working in that environment. So there's two pieces to this. So let's say this person is working in that environment, okay, and the immune system will definitely try to attack that, okay? So understand that macrophages will try to come and eat and get rid of that silica. Unfortunately, it cannot do it at a fast rate, okay, and especially if this patient has continuous exposure, okay? If macrophages come and try to eat away all of this, do you think it's going to damage the lung tissue along with it? Mm-hmm. Yes, it will. Okay. And so what will happen here, keep in mind lung tissue is simple squamous epithelium, which means that if you have high amounts of macrophages and the immune system attacking in that area, it's definitely going to damage the lung tissue with it. So these patients can now have further progression of the disease process because of that. Okay. And also, because of the chronic exposure, it will get to the point where it's just going to infiltrate the lung tissue and it is going to be irreversible, okay, and it's not much you can do. Okay. Now, the next categories we're going to go into are cellular adaptations. Oh, good. I'm doing good on time. I think I'm going to be done with this at 3:30, and we'll do the activity for an hour and then come back. All right. So this is now where you guys are going to pull out your pictures. Okay, so the pictures that I gave you, you're going to incorporate that. Okay, Okay, so there are a few cellular adaptations that can occur. So the first topic we have is atrophy. Atrophy is a decrease in cell size. So this is where the cell shrinks. Okay. Now, there are a number of different things that can cause this, and I'll go over the causes. The picture that I have for you guys is a picture of muscle atrophy. So let's say, for example, this is a person that has, this is still reversible.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So all of the cellular adaptations are still reversible except for dysplasia. And I'll show you when we get to dysplasia. So for atrophy, if you look at that person's leg, okay, so let's say maybe, for example, they had some sort of fracture, the cast was on for however long, and because of the immobility, okay, that this person had to their leg, the muscle actually became in a state of atrophy, okay, because of disuse, okay, and so that's a good example of muscle atrophy. So here are some causes. Disuse, okay, like the picture. Denervation is a decrease or a lack of nerve supply. This is a lack of nerve supply, denervation. Denervation is a lack of nerve supply. So let's say, for example, we have a person that has some sort of crushing injury and this nerve was severed and, you know, something happened to the nerve, that will cause atrophy as well. Ischemia is a lack of blood supply. Okay, so if you don't have enough blood supply going to the region, that's also going to be an issue. Nutrient starvation. Okay, so you're probably wondering, what is that? What type of nutrients? Nutrients we're talking about here are ions. Okay, so if you want to write down ions. Remember, ions are needed for cell function. And so if for some reason we don't have the adequate amount of ions to perform that function, it's also going to go into atrophy. Interruption of endocrine signals. These are going to be hormones. So keep in mind that there are times where the endocrine system, we know, definitely controls other systems in the body and other functions, other organs. And so let's say, for example, if a person has a decrease in their thyroid hormone, okay, with the thyroid itself may atrophy, it is a possibility, okay? So keep in mind that that can also cause the atrophy. Persistent cell injury and aging. Those are pretty self-explanatory. So if you have persistent cell injury, the cell will be damaged, okay, which will make it smaller. And aging, we know as we age overall, things shrink, okay? And so that's that. So this diagram here, normal, atrophy is a decrease in cell size. Hypertrophy is an increase in cell size. Hyperplasia has nothing to do with size. This is all number. So it's an increase in cell number. But obviously, if we have an increase in cell number, that's going to make the organ or the tissue larger. Okay. Metaplasia is a conversion of one cell type to the next. But what you see here, and I like this picture, they show you that it can convert back. So this is still considered reversible. Now when we get to dysplasia, this is irreversible. Everything else is reversible except dysplasia. Dysplasia is irreversible. Okay, and I'll explain. For dysplasia, this is also considered to be precancerous. Okay, so when a patient has dysplasia, that's nothing that you want to just play around with. That has to be definitely treated and managed. Okay, so you would never want dysplasia to be inside of a tissue or organ and just let it sit there and think it's going to correct itself. Okay, now, and I'll talk more about dysplasia in a little bit, but just know that this starts irreversible. Now, for those of you who read the book, you're going to read in your book that it says dysplasia is reversible, but I want you to understand that dysplasia can only be reversible with treatment. Okay, so it can be reversed with treatment because what they'll do is they'll surgically remove the tissue. Okay, so that's the only way it can be reversed, with treatment. But as far as just the adaptation, it's irreversible. Okay. So hypertrophy, increase in cell size, and so what happens here, they say that hypertrophy can happen physiologically and pathophysiologically. Okay, so there's two different ways this can develop. So let me give you a good example. So let's say we have a male, okay, that wants to bulk up, okay, and so let's say he's going to the gym 3-4 times a week, okay, and not only going to the gym and, you know, increasing the muscle contractions and weight training, but this gentleman is also feeding his body the proper nutrition, increasing his protein intake, his water intake, okay, so everything to get larger. So that is what we would call a physiological hypertrophy, and that's okay, because that person is feeding those muscle cells what they need, okay, so the muscle cells can get larger. Now, let's say a pathophysiological hypertrophy is when, let's say when I was in Mammoth, and let's say if I stayed there too long and my heart kept going really fast, with the heart contracting that fast, okay, over a period of time, the heart is a muscle, do you think it would get larger maybe at one point? Yes, it can, okay, so keep in mind that the heart can go into cardiomegaly sometimes in certain cardiac conditions. And so that would be a pathophysiological hypertrophy because of the issue. Okay. Is everyone good with that?
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So the picture that you have for hypertrophy, it's different than the picture I have here, but it's the same thing pretty much. That is the cardiomegaly, or if you want to say muscle hypertrophy of the heart. Okay. And so as you can see here, the tissue is very, very thick, okay, in that chamber, as opposed to this one, okay? Even on this side as well. So this is probably the left ventricle, and that's probably the right. And so even the right ventricle is thickened as well, okay? But in the picture that you guys have, it just really shows the left being really thick. Okay. Yes?
Is like gigantism, where the pituitary gland, it secretes,
Yeah, so for that condition, those patients can also have a cardiomegaly, and it's because of the hormones. And so the hormones will also cause the cell to increase. So just kind of like with atrophy, when we talked about the causes, and we talked about a decline, but then if there's an elevation, then it could cause it to be larger.
Would that be considered physiological or
pathophysiological? Oh, that would be pathophysiological. Yeah, that would be pathophysiological. Because it's an underlying disease process. Okay, so hyperplasia, this is an increase in cell number, okay? And so the reason why it's an increase in cell number is because of mitosis. There's an increase in mitosis with this. And the picture that I have for you guys, I know it looks kind of strange that I have callus formation, but callus formation is a very good example of hyperplasia, okay? So let me explain. They say that hyperplasia can be a physiological demand or hormonal. So that particular one with the foot is a physiological demand. So let's say, for example, that's a dancer, okay? And so we know what dancers, okay, or even people that use their hands, if you're looking at your hands, and sometimes people weight train without gloves and things like that. And so what happens here is that if you have any type of friction to the epithelium, okay, we would think that it's gonna wear away, okay, with that. But what it does really is the more friction, the more it increases mitosis. So it's actually gonna increase in the number of cells and make it thick, okay. And that thickening, it's amazing how the body works, because that thickening is really making a protective barrier, okay? It's more protection that the body's doing. So that is a good example of hyperplasia. Okay. And then we have hormonal stimulation. Very good example, BPH. You guys may have heard of it. Benign prosthetic hyperplasia. Okay, so what happens here, men, as they get older, sometimes can have prostate enlargement. And the reason why the prostate, they say, can get enlarged is because of the hormonal imbalance. Okay, so that can also lead to that type of hyperplasia.
What is that,
PH?
Which one?
BPH. Oh, BPH. All right. Benign prostatic hyperplasia. So sometimes when men get older, they can have prostate enlargement. Now sometimes you'll hear it as a hypertrophy, but technically it's a hyperplasia. Okay. Overall, it is getting larger, but it's the cellular adaptation is a hyperplasia. So benign prostatic hyperplasia. So they do believe that that can happen because of hormonal imbalances. And so that's another good example. Okay. Now the last, no, well, not the last one. Excuse me. Metaplasia, almost the last one. Metaplasia is a conversion of one cell type to another, and it can reverse back to normal. Okay. So for this one, I'm going to pick on the smokers in the room. Okay. So you guys remember, what is the normal epithelium in the airway? Not squamous. A little more. This, okay. No, it is ciliated. Okay. All right. Somebody said columnar. Yes, it is pseudo stratified. Okay. So let's pull it together. All right. So ciliated, pseudo stratified, columnar epithelium. Okay, so it's ciliated because remember we need the cilia to sweep out debris. It is pseudostratified, multiple layers, okay, and the columnar to resist abrasions. Okay, so we do need that thickening, okay, in the airway. Now, when people smoke, and whether they've been smoking 7 days or 7 years, okay, every time a person smokes, it is definitely causing irritation to the airway. Okay, and obviously more irritation the longer a person smokes. So a person that's a chronic smoker, what happens is this. The cilia will be burnt off, and actually the columnar epithelium will go down to a squamous. Okay, so it transforms. The epithelium transforms with smoking. Okay, so not to scare you, but that's what it does. Now, what do you notice with chronic smokers, what they always have? They always have a chronic cough, okay? Why? Because their epithelium changed and they don't have the protection anymore. So there's no cilia to sweep out anything. The columnar is squished down, okay? And another thing you notice with chronic smokers is that they always have upper respiratory infections, okay? They always have some kind of cold or something going on because there's no more protection in the airway. So, good thing is, once the person stops smoking and they kick the habit, the epithelium can change back to normal. Okay, so that's a good thing. So now we go back to the columnar, the cilia can regenerate, and now we can function. Have you ever been around a person that stopped smoking? What do you notice that they have right after they stop? They still cough, very good, but it's productive. Yes, they have a lot of mucus. Okay, that comes out. Very productive cough and sputum. Why? Because now we have the cilia, and they can get out all that gook that's been sitting there, okay, forever long. And so now they can get everything out, okay? So it's actually a good thing that it converts back, okay? However, I just want you to put this into the back of your head that if you have a cell in one tissue type that can change to another type of cell in the same tissue type. Do we think that's normal? No, probably not. And we don't want to say it's cancerous at this point, but the fact that the cells can change like that, that is sort of a precursor to a dysplasia. Okay, so I just want you to have that in the back of your head. Not in every case, okay, but in some cases. Okay, so that's just something to keep in the back of your mind with that. So having a metaplasia is not always a good thing. Okay. Dysplasia.
Oh, I'm sorry. Let me go to the picture. The picture I have for metaplasia, to be honest, I need you guys to cross that out. It's not a great picture. I was supposed to replace that, and that's my fault. The picture for metaplasia, you can cross that out. I'm not going to test you on that picture, okay, because it's really not a good-looking picture. So you don't have to worry about that. However, if you just want to look at some other forms of metaplasia, just go on Pinterest. I think I have some other examples, or they have some also in your book, okay? All right. So dysplasia, this is the last one. Dysplasia, as we said, is precancerous. This is what we call the disordered appearance of cells, okay? And so these cells now look totally different. We don't know what they are. We can't tell the size, the shape, or what it is. And yes, it's precancerous. Now, the picture that you guys have, I put there normal so you can see the difference. And so the normal side, what you're looking at there, is actually simple squamous epithelium. That's simple squamous epithelium, and that's actually in the cervix in the female. That's simple squamous epithelium. And the abnormality that you see with all of those cells, very dark and clustered together, that's actually cervical dysplasia. Okay, that's cervical dysplasia. Cervical dysplasia, I picked that one because that's actually a little common sometimes. And so cervical dysplasia is this. I think they still do these procedures. When I used to work in a GYN office, when patients had cervical dysplasia, understand that that tissue has to be removed. That should not stay there. So they would do procedures like a cryo. I think they still do that, where they freeze off the epithelium, or they do a loop where they remove the epithelium, just kind of scrape out that area. So they have to remove that tissue. And so the purpose of it is, once that tissue is removed, you want to see how those cells are going to regenerate back to hopefully normal. And if it goes back to that, or maybe worse, that's when they'll start to diagnose the particular cancer, okay? And so just understand that dysplasia, the only way it is reversible is through removal, and really you have to remove it. The treatment is you have to remove that tissue, okay? And go from there. Okay, my practice question isn't working. Well, I did it wrong. I should say it's not working. I actually set it up wrong. My plan is to have Kahoot questions, like practice questions for you guys, but I will have to come back to that at the end of class, okay, because I was having an issue with it. Okay. So we're going to break up this want lecture, okay, and let me... If you guys can pull out the page that says necrosis activity. So this is going to be our first active lesson that we're going to do. You guys will do this as a group project, okay? And let me just go over some things. So normally when I do active lessons in the classroom, it's usually going to be on topics that I feel that don't have really heavy duty pathogenesis that, you know, needs a lot of explanation. I think some of us do have some common knowledge of necrosis, and so I think we'll be able to get through this. So this is what we're going to do. Let me just highlight some things, just a few points here that we want to make about necrosis. So when you guys think of necrosis, what do you think is causing it? What do you think causes necrosis? Okay. Oh, well, let me say that, yes. Thank you. Let me go to the definition first. Necrosis, yes, is cell death. Okay, I'm jumping ahead of myself. So necrosis is cell death. Okay, and necrosis is also irreversible, as you would imagine. So once we have a cell that is going to die, that's it. Okay, so there's no turning back. And so one of the possible causes of necrosis, we would imagine, would be very good, a lack of, I'm going to say, oxygenated blood.
okay, so let's just say oxygenated blood, or even just blood itself, but lack of oxygenated blood. Necrosis can also happen too sometimes because of toxicity. I shouldn't say rare cases, but some cases. Usually it's mostly due to a lack of blood supply, but there are some times where it can be due to toxicity. And you guys may have gone over that maybe in micro. Yes?
What's the difference between necrosis and apoptosis?
And apoptosis?
Yeah.
Apoptosis is considered programmed cell death. So that's basically more an immune system response. So the body will pretty much tell certain cells to die. It kind of programs it. It does that actually with cancer and some other diseases. But the body does kill some cancer cells, so it's just like a programmed cell death from the immune system. This is cell death due to injury, due to something external. So injury or toxicity. Now, let me also tell you the difference between necrosis and gangrene. Okay, so sometimes we hear these terms, and they even use them sometimes together, okay? But as far as pathophysiology is concerned, they do mean the same thing, but they use the term depending on the tissue type we're talking about or the body part. So necrosis is used if we're talking about the tissue, and gangrene is used if we're talking about the body part. Okay, so I'll give you an example. Say you have a patient that has, one of the things, the first one here, coagulative necrosis, and in parentheses I put dry gangrene, okay, which is the same thing. Coagulative necrosis, dry gangrene. So let's say, for example, you have a patient that has frostbite, okay, and there's a lack of blood that was to the extremities and the fingers, okay, and so led them into this type of situation. So let's say you're explaining to the patient's wondering, okay, why did my fingers, you know, why are they black, why are they dry? You would explain to the patient, if you're explaining the pathogenesis, you would say to them that the tissue became necrotic because of the lack of blood flow, blah, 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 blah. If you were, say, for example, maybe explaining to another clinician or, you know, the doctor, you would say the finger's gangrenous, okay, or the hand is gangrenous. So the gangrene is used for the body part, whereas the necrosis term is used to talk about the tissue. Does that make sense? Okay, so just so you'll make it the distinction, because sometimes you'll read, and you guys will read this, so they'll just kind of combine those two terms together. So what you guys are gonna do for the assignment, I'm gonna have you guys break up the entire class, break up into groups. So I just need 5 groups, okay? If you wanna do it by row, because I think we have 5 rows, you can do it that way, or if you wanna work with someone that you like, that's okay. But I just need 5 groups, and each group is gonna take a different topic, okay? So for the instructions, for number 1, you're gonna make a mold of the necrosis. So as I told you earlier, I do have flesh-colored clay in the back. I would like you guys to try to make these molds as realistic as possible, because you will be visualizing necrosis on your patients, okay? And so it's nice to kind of get a hands-on look at it. You're not gonna be graded on your artwork, okay? However, I do want you to try to make it as realistic as you can. So try to choose someone that's really good with that. The next thing you're gonna do is make an outline. So say, for example, you can have maybe 2 members work on the mold, maybe the other members in the group can help form the outline. So you guys are gonna type up an outline. The outline is gonna include the etiology, risk factor, pathogenesis, signs and symptoms, and treatment for that particular necrosis, okay? And once you're done with your outline, you're gonna put it on doc sharing. Okay, so you're gonna go to Blackboard, doc sharing, and then you'll see where it says week 1 activity on necrosis. You're gonna click on that, and you're gonna do a blog entry. And then you're gonna upload your outline. Those of you who are typing the outline, just make it one page. I don't need a lengthy outline. Try to make it simple, okay, so we don't have to go into a lot of detail, but I will come over, you know, individually and work with the groups. And make sure everyone in your group that their name is on that paper so everyone can get credit, okay? And so I just need one paper per group uploaded onto DocSharing. And another good thing, these papers will be actually open to the whole class, so you guys can look at these outlines to study for the test. And I'm going to make questions directly from your outlines for the necrosis, okay? So that's that. And the other thing too with necrosis, let me just use yours for a second. The pictures that I have here for the different types of necrosis and gangrenes, I do want you guys to memorize these pictures also for next week's test, because I will put these pictures on the test, okay, in addition to the outline. Okay. All right. So, we know what we're doing? Okay. Okay, so for chapter 7, there are three tables in your textbook that I do need you to know. Okay, and so I wrote here on the board what the tables are and also what they for. Okay, let me. I don't want to be in your picture.
What is the very last one?
Colorectal. Did I spell it right? Sometimes my spelling is more crazy. No, that's fine. Okay, so these are the tables. So for you, you're using the fourth edition.
Yeah.
Table 7-6, it's numbered differently. So just look for the table that says tumor markers.
Okay.
Okay.
I
think it's 7-8 or something like that. I can't remember exactly what it is. But it has a different number. Okay. All right. So for these tables, this is just extra information that I need you guys to review to actually study from for next week's test. So table 7-1 goes over characteristics of cancer. Table 7-2 goes over names of cancers, okay? And 7-6 covers tumor markers, okay? And tumor markers, if you look at that table, there's actually a lot. I'm making it easier for you guys for memorization, and I only need you to memorize the tumor markers for the top four cancers, which I listed here, breast, prostate, lung, and colorectal. Okay, so breast, prostate, lung, and colorectal, those are the top four cancers, so just only memorize the tumor markers for those. Now, just to also let you know about the tumor markers, if you take a look at that table, there's actually, let's say for example, maybe three or four tumor markers for breast cancer, okay? So what you should do is in your outline, just make a couple of columns, okay, breast, prostate, lung, colorectal, and then just list the tumor markers under each one, okay, because they're going to be most likely more than one, okay? And so that'll make things a little easier for you, okay? But as you can see, there's a lot of tumor markers here for all different cancers. We don't have to get that detailed, but at least for the top four, okay? All right. So for chapter 7, as you can see, we are definitely going to cover cancer. And so within this chapter, we're just going to talk about just a basic overview of what cancer is, the difference between benign and malignant tumors. We're also going to cover signs and symptoms, how it's diagnosed, cancer treatments as well. Okay, and so just an overview of some things. I have a video here, but unfortunately I don't have time to show it, but we'll be okay. All right. So neoplasia, when you look at this particular term, neo means new, plasia means growth. So this is new growth, okay, that's occurring. Now, obviously, when we talk about cancer, this is not normal, you know, new growth. This is abnormal growth that's occurring. So it does apply to an abnormality of cellular growth in tumors.
Malignant neoplasia is cancer. So usually when you hear the term malignancy, it's always usually going to be associated with cancer itself, that term. Cancer and malignancy kind of goes together. Benign growth is usually generally easily cured. And if you want to also add to this, when you hear the term benign, sometimes they'll just use it as a benign tumor, where sometimes you may hear people say benign cancer, but technically you would use cancer more for malignancy and tumors more for benign, okay? Malignant cancer may not be survivable, which we know, and in certain cases we'll talk about that. And cancer is definitely associated with an altered gene expression. So if you read most books regarding cancer, a lot of scientists do believe that we all have a cancer cell inside of us. It's just a matter if that normal cell is going to undergo a faulty mitosis and turn into a cancer cell. And so this is one of the issues with cancer research, okay, because how does this happen? We don't have a known cause for this sort of alteration. We wish we did. And then the other issue with cancer research is the mitosis. So how can we control mitosis just with cancer and not anything else without, you know, shutting down mitosis in the rest of the body? And so those are the challenges with it. So benign versus malignant. Malignant tumors can kill the host if untreated. They are confirmed by their invasive or metastasizing nature. So I think we all know that when patients do have malignant tumors, we know that they can spread not only to neighboring tissue, but also spread to distant sites. They do have something called tissue-specific differentiation. Okay, say that three times. So that term, tissue-specific differentiation, what that means is that, say for example, a person is undergoing testing to diagnose cancer. And so let's say a biopsy is performed, okay, which is, you know, usually a definitive diagnosis with that. So if a biopsy is performed, what they do is they take a look at the tissue in the lab, and they look at how the cells, if they match closely to the tissue type that it came from. So if it matches closely to the tissue type that it came from, that would be more along a benign type of cancer or tumor. If you have a tissue type where the cells are in a total disarray, you can't even tell what tissue it came from, then that's more along the lines of a malignancy, okay? And so we'll talk about this a little more when we talk about grading later. So you guys know how we hear cancer, a person's in stage 1, 2, 3, or 4, but I want you guys to know there's also a grading procedure that's done in the lab, okay? And so the pathologist will take a look at it and they'll grade the tissue. And so this is what they'll look for. Another thing here is that malignant tumors do grow very rapidly, and they say here they may initiate tumor vessel growth, which means these malignant tumors that occur actually have a lot of blood vessels surrounding them, okay? And so keep in mind, just like anything else in the body that needs blood supply, so if these tumors have blood supply to, you know, feed off of, it will get bigger. And so these tumors can grow because of that. Another issue is that these tumors can also become very necrotic, okay? So just as much as blood supply that's supplying that tumor, say for example that blood supply stops, okay, in that diseased tissue, it can definitely become necrotic, okay? And as we were talking earlier, sometimes when patients do have necrotic tissue inside their bodies, and you guys went over necrosis, and so we know with necrotic tissue that it, you know, has either a dry appearance or wet, different colors, things like that. But just understand that necrotic tissue can also be very smelly, okay? And so it can smell very, very bad, okay, dead tissue. And so that can happen. Now, benign. Benign tumors do not have the potential to kill a host, but may be life-threatening because of its location. So usually benign tumors are not a big, big issue depending on the location. So say for example, if someone has a benign tumor, let's say in the trachea, okay? So obviously that will be an issue because there's going to be blockage there for the airway. So that may need to be removed. As opposed to, let's say someone has a lipoma, just a little fatty cyst, okay, somewhere in the body. People usually don't like them for cosmetic reasons, but it doesn't have to be removed immediately, okay? They do not invade adjacent tissue or spread to distant sites because they are encapsulated, okay? So benign tumors are usually well confined in their own little space. They're not invading any neighboring tissue. They're well encapsulated in their area. During a biopsy, they do resemble more of the original tissue type. Okay, so even if they see a little bit of a disarray of the cells, they can still look at some of the surrounding cells and can still distinguish that, okay, this is the cervix, this is the stomach, this is the liver. Okay, so they can still figure what tissue type it is. Now, benign tumors do grow more slowly because there's not a lot of blood vessels surrounding them. Okay, so that's why they stay in their own little area. And they also rarely become necrotic. So, table 7-1 has more characteristics for cancers, okay, for benign and malignant. So you can just take a look at that to add on. Now, I just want to show you one more thing with benign. There are some other distinctions that we can take a look at. So, say for example, if someone has a lesion that's palpable, okay, so let's say someone has something on the skin and they may be concerned about skin cancer, okay. So we know that sometimes when there are certain lesions that are visible, you can look at the color and different changes that may happen. Let's say that we have something that is raised, okay, and you can palpate it and see if it moves. Okay, so when you have something that's benign and you're able to palpate it and feel it, if it's mobile, okay, if it's able to move, that's usually along the signs of a benign, okay, so that's usually a better sign if it's movable. Same situation as you guys know when they look at the thyroid and looking to see the movement there, they're looking for movement because movement is good. If there's no movement, that's not a good thing. So if it's fixed, not moving, that's more along the signs of malignancy. Okay, and I'll tell you why. So, when we talk about something being fixed, let's imagine what this tumor is looking like. It's going to look like this as opposed to this. Okay, so remember how we said that benign tumors are well encapsulated, so which means that they're encapsulated, they're all a little bubble, okay? But when we talk about now a malignant tumor, it is not encapsulated, and so now it has these sort of jagged edges here, or what we call sometimes pseudo-arms, meaning that this presentation means that this tumor is probably now extending into the neighboring tissue and on its way to spread, okay? And because it is extending into the tissue and kind of latching on, this is what also makes it not mobile. Not able to move in that situation. So just to show you two other things with that. Okay, now, table 7-2, if you take a look at that in your book, it has a whole list of names of cancers, okay? Now, I don't want you to memorize each and every cancer, okay, but I just wanted you to draw your attention to that table so you can see the difference. So what I'm going to go over with you now is the nomenclature of how we name cancers. Okay, so when I go over this, you'll be able to look at any cancer, okay, and figure out if it's benign or malignant. So when you look at these names, excuse me, the first thing you want to take a look at is the organ, okay, and then we always would look at the suffix. Okay, so the organ's the organ, and then the suffix is going to tell you if it's benign or malignant. So the suffix that we have here is oma. Okay, oma, O-M-A. So oma is the suffix that indicates a benign tumor. Okay, so anytime you see a word ending in oma, that's going to be for benign. So say, for example, lipoma. Okay, oma, benign tumor, lipo, fatty tissue.
okay, a fatty cell. So benign tumor of fatty tissue. Carcinoma and sarcoma, even though it has oma, okay, within that entire word, but this is the entire thing is a suffix, carcinoma and sarcoma, okay? So anytime you see these two at the end of an organ, a word of an organ, that's going to indicate malignant tumors. So carcinoma is going to be a malignant tumor of epithelial origin, okay? And so, say for example, basal cell carcinoma, okay? Carcinoma of the basal cell epithelium, okay, in the lung. Sarcoma is a malignant tumor of mesenchymal origin. Okay, so what's mesenchymal origin? That's going to be anything that's bone or muscle tissue. Okay, anything that's bone or muscle tissue. Or cartilage, things like that. Bone, muscle, cartilage. So, very good example, osteosarcoma. Okay, osteosarcoma, malignant tumor of the bone. Okay, osteosarcoma. Now, leukemia, we know they're in a class by itself, okay, because this is a malignancy of white blood cells. Also, lymphoma, okay, is also in a class by itself. So, let me just show you, lymphoma is actually an exception to the rule that I just went over. I hope my board is in the view and camera. I move around so much. Like I need an actual cameraman. Okay. I just figured it was all the way over there. Okay. So lymphoma. Lymphoma is the exception to the rule. So look at this. Lymphoma ends with oma. Okay. So we already know oma is benign. However, lymphoma is actually going to be looked at as a malignancy. And I'll tell you why. Leukemias and lymphomas are looked at as malignancies, okay? And the reason why is this. We know that cancer travels through the blood and the lymphatic system, correct? Okay, so if a patient has a primary cancer in the bloodstream or primary cancer in the lymphatic system, we would never want to look at that and think it's benign. Okay, so anytime the primary cancer is in those two regions, it's always looked at as a malignancy, okay? Now, lymphomas have different stages. They may not be that aggressive. However, it's still always looked at as a malignancy. Okay. All right. So that's that. So the next page we have here. Now, you don't have to memorize these percentages, but I just want to point something out here. So in the future, just to let you guys know, don't put any test questions of percentages, okay? So that's more for like if we had an epidemiology class, if you had to know something like that. But I just have this here to show you the top four cancers. So the first category here, A, goes over the cancers that are actually diagnosed. And the second category goes over the cancers that actually result in death, okay? So if you notice in both categories, the top four cancers are the ones you guys broke down already. Breast, prostate, lung, and colorectal. Those are the top four cancers. So just make sure you know that one. Okay. So with cancer, as we said earlier, there is no known cause for it. However, there are tons of different risk factors possibly linked to cancer. So tobacco use is one. Okay, and we'll talk about that in detail in a second. Nutrition is another one, obesity, sun exposure for skin cancer, and then sexual exposure to HPV. And they have in parentheses cervical cancer. However, I think you guys know that HPV has also been linked to oral cancer in men. Okay, so it's not just only focused to women. Okay, so for tobacco use. Now, when we think about, well, number one, for tobacco use, keep in mind tobacco use is not only just cigarette smoking, but it is chewing tobacco, the vapes, hookah, what else? That's it, right? For tobacco. What is it? Chew.
Well, yes, chewing tobacco. I don't know. I haven't seen people chew tobacco in years. I don't know if they still do that. They do have it. They still have chewing tobacco. Okay. Yes.
Is there any like correlation with like the patches?
You know, that's a good question. I don't know if the studies with that. But I'm going to say that the carcinogens are higher with the actual smoke. But it's going to be also interesting to see the new studies with the vapes since they came out, because I think there's more use of it with the vapes because people think it's more of a watered-down version. But it still has tobacco in it. And so, it'll be interesting to see the new studies on that. But I think, I want to say it's more with the actual smoke itself. So when we think of tobacco use, we are always immediately link it to lung cancer, okay? But I do want you guys to know that tobacco use can also be linked to these other cancers, pancreatic, kidney, bladder, mouth, esophageal, and cervical cancer, okay? And I actually know someone, knew someone that actually died of esophageal cancer from smoking. Now, with smoking, there are two types of carcinogens. Okay, so even though the tobacco industry is a $1 billion industry, you know that they have to show you these smoking commercials to scare you half to death, okay? Because they do know that there are known carcinogens. This is known research. So there are two main types of carcinogens we have is the initiator, which causes the genetic damage. So basically, the initiator is actually going to cause this autogene expression. Once we have this now new growth of a cancer cell, the second type of carcinogen is the promoter. Now it's going to promote tumor growth. So now that's a double whammy. Okay, and again, this is a known fact in tobacco smoke. So tobacco smoke contains both types. Secondhand smoke is just as bad. So just please keep that in mind. So people that do live with individuals that smoke, and also people that work in casinos and things like that also are part of this. Now, nutrition. There are dietary factors that are believed to also be a risk for cancer. So fat, just to give you some information, fat has been linked to breast cancer. So people that have diets high in fat. Fiber. Low fiber has been linked to colorectal cancer, as we would imagine. Colorectal. And recent studies, not too recent, but studies have also shown that smoked meats have also been linked to colon cancer and pancreatic cancer. Okay, so bacon, chorizo, all those sausages, and things that are in a smokehouse. So the theory is this. Those type of meats go in a smokehouse to get their flavor. And so they believe that those carcinogens are still in the smoke. And so instead of it, you know, you're smoking it, you're actually ingesting the carcinogens. So that's the theory behind it. Yeah, that's the theory behind it. And keep in mind, when I had some neighbors when I was in New Jersey, and they had a smokehouse, and you know they would make their own sausages and everything. And so keep in mind that those meats, they stay in there for quite a time to get the flavor. So yeah, so I know, I just upset everybody's weekend. All right, so be careful with ingesting too many smoked meats. All right. Alcohol, we would imagine, yes, that can cause issues. So alcohol, yes, is linked to liver cancer, as we would imagine. And it is also linked to, breast and esophageal. Alcohol is also linked to breast, esophageal cancer, and liver cancer. Now, antioxidants, I know it looks kind of strange, okay, that it's on this list here. It really should be kind of different on a different list. But antioxidants, we know, is actually a good thing. We know that they're naturally in some of our fruits and berries, especially like pomegranates and blueberries. And so antioxidants are actually really good to have in your diet. And what they do
It's just what it says in the term. Antioxidant, antioxidation. So remember how I said in chapter one that most cellular disease process starts with an oxidation reaction? So antioxidant stops that reaction, okay, which is a good thing. And so having a diet rich in antioxidants is not only good for cancer prevention, but it's also good just for other diseases as well. Okay, so metastasis, when you have a cancer that's going to metastasize, we know it's going to travel through either the bloodstream or the lymphatic system to get to whatever organ it wants to attach to, okay? So the best way I can explain this, did you guys see the movie Look Who's Talking? It's an old movie.
Yeah.
Okay, Look Who's Talking, the first one. Yes. So remember in the beginning, they show the fertilization with the sperm traveling to get to the egg, and then it gets in, okay? So that process of fertilization and how that happens is actually the same situation that happens when cancer actually tries to metastasize to a different organ. So the cells will actually escape, it'll travel through the blood, and when it goes to the tissue type that it wants to attach to, it has enzymes and a receptor that it will actually release and just pierce itself right inside. Okay, so it's pretty much the same setup. So this is what they're showing you here in that diagram. Okay. And this diagram is in your book also, if you want to take a look at it. So patterns of spread. So again, we already just discussed how cancer can spread through the circulatory system or the lymphatic system. But one thing that we definitely want to go into detail with here are tumor markers. Okay. So I don't know if you guys ever wondered, like say for example, if a patient comes to you, okay, and they have, let's say cancer, okay, that has metastasized in multiple organs, how do you know which one was the primary cancer? Okay, how do you know that? So the body is very smart, and so the body is designed to always release a tumor marker for the primary cancer. So even if a patient has metastasis, you would never be tricked to figuring out which one is the primary cancer, okay? So tumor markers, they do help identify parent tissue or the primary cancer. And so what a tumor marker is this. A tumor marker is actually going to be maybe an antigen. It could be a hormone, even. Something that's going to be released from that primary cancer, okay? And it can be tested either with blood work or biopsy. Okay, so it can be tested either with blood work or biopsy. So sometimes if a patient, they're ready trying to figure out how to diagnose the cancer, there may be a special lab order that will be ordered for the blood work. Or sometimes with biopsy, they can see certain things that are secreted. Okay, and that's how they know it's the parent cancer. So what's the point of this? It's nice to know the primary cancer because it can help with treatment and management. So sometimes the oncologists know that certain cancers behave certain ways, and so they can kind of track the tumor activity and kind of know if it's going to metastasize to a certain place. Angiogenesis, kind of talked about this a little bit with malignancy. So with malignant tumors, we know that they have a lot of blood vessels surrounding them. So angiogenesis, if you remember this term from anatomy, it is the formation of blood vessels, okay? And so the more blood vessels that are formed, the bigger the tumor, okay? The only thing I really want you to focus on here is this last sentence where it says inhibition of angiogenesis is important. The inhibition of angiogenesis is an important therapeutic goal. And if you want to also write down and add to that, this is where radiation therapy helps. Radiation treatment with cancer patients, actually the goal is to try to kill the blood vessels surrounding the tumor to try to shrink it. Okay, so that's the goal of radiation therapy, is to try to shrink the tumor, but it's really killing to try to kill the blood vessels surrounding to shrink the tumor. And so that hopefully will stop the angiogenesis. So grading and staging. So again, a biopsy can be performed, okay, to help diagnose the cancer. And what the pathologist will look at in the lab, they're going to look at these cells and see basically how bad they are, okay? And so they will grade this according to, you know, the damage that has happened. And so they do have three or four classes here. And so this term where it says degree of anaplasia, remember we went over dysplasia? So anaplasia is kind of, is like a higher degree of dysplasia. Okay, so what is the, I should say the class that it falls under? Staging. Staging cancer is looking at the patient. Okay. So does this patient have a tumor just in the cervical lymph node? Or now does this patient have a tumor, or I should say metastasized throughout the cervical lymphatic chain? Has it now spread to the axillary chain? Is it now in the breast? Is it in the lung? Okay, so what is the extent of the spread of this cancer? That's how you stage it, okay? So we would imagine, okay, one little lymph node would be maybe a stage one, whereas two would be something that spread maybe down a lymphatic chain. Three or four, it will spread to multiple organs, okay? So that's how staging is performed. Now, let me just give you the full abbreviation for this, the full thing for this abbreviation. So TNM is a system that's used, again, just looking at the different body parts. And so T stands for tumor. So basically is a tumor in one location, okay, T for tumor. N is for lymph node. I know. N is for lymph node. Why did they put it as N? I don't know. Maybe there's another abbreviation for TLM, I don't know. Okay, so N stands for lymph node or nodal involvement. M, metastasis. M is for metastasis. So that's pretty much the order. So they say here that the results of staging determines the treatment modality. So let's say, for example, if a patient has a tumor, again, going back to the cervical lymph node, maybe just radiation therapy will be okay for that. But if we have a patient that has cancer, let's say, in the cervical lymph node, all throughout the lymphatic chain, multiple organs, then that patient's gonna need chemotherapy. Radiation therapy alone is not gonna do it, okay? So it just depends on the involvement, how they're gonna treat it. Now, the next two slides, I will tell you this, and I'll definitely tell you guys if I see something somewhere, like in an NCLEX review book or whatever. Oh, speaking of that, I didn't tell you earlier. Make sure you guys look at NCLEX review books, okay, to help study for your tests, especially those type of test questions. The way I make my test, I use some of the, you know, test bank questions they have for the book. However, I also look at NCLEX review books, and I look at their format of questions, and that's how I also make my own test questions for our test here. So it's not too early to pick up an NCLEX review book. They do have NCLEX review books just for pathophysiology, okay, so those would be good ones, I would say, to get. And they also have some apps on the phone as well, okay, and so you guys can also take a look at that. Now, this slide, excuse me, and the next slide, I actually saw this as a question in an NCLEX review book, okay. Now, is this going to be on your NCLEX? I don't know, maybe. So, let's go over this. And they actually had the acronym, CAUTION, okay, which I was surprised they had the acronym as a question. So CAUTION is the acronym, and it goes over basically warning signs of cancer, okay? So this is just really pretty much memorization. However, if you take a look at this, it just kind of goes over some of the warning signs that we would imagine that you would see in certain types of cancers in different body parts. So change in bowel or bladder habits. So obviously if there's a change in a bowel habit, that's gonna be more for colon cancer. Bladder habit, that's gonna be for bladder cancer. A sore that does not heal, That overall really can be for any cancer, but that would also be probably more localized to skin cancer, okay? So you get the picture, okay, as you go through. Now, warning signs for cancer in children, okay? So again, this was also another question. However, the question, I don't think they had the acronym. However, the big picture here with cancer in children is this. These warning signs, when you read through this, we have here, okay, unexplained weight loss, headaches, maybe bone pain, fevers, maybe a bruise or bleeding, okay? Those, unfortunately, are normal day-to-day things that happen with children, okay? So the big picture you should get from this slide is that the warning signs for cancer in children actually mimic the normal childhood diseases, okay? And so that is the big take-home message there. And so this is why sometimes cancer in children can go underdiagnosed, okay, because of that. Pain. Pain is, they say, a common and fear complication. Yes, we know that. However, pain can be in any disease process, but with cancer patients, the pain can come from not only the cancer disease itself, but it can also come from the cancer treatment. And so what you guys will do is definitely help control that pain by giving them something to control the pain with analgesics or any type of other pain relievers. Okay, now, cachexia. Can never get that out. Cachexia. Cachexia is what we call this overall weakness or muscle wasting. Okay, so anyone in here ever seen anyone with cancer in a stage 3 or 4? Okay, so you know what that looks like. And so this is that, this category. So what happens here is when we have patients, unfortunately, that get into the later stages of cancer, they do have this generalized muscle wasting that occurs, and weight loss and weakness. They do have a loss of appetite, which definitely also contributes to that. Increased metabolic rate, which contributes also to the weight loss, but the increase in metabolic rate is occurring because of the cancer, okay, because of that rapid mitosis that's happening. And nausea and vomiting. The nausea and vomiting happens because the stomach lining, they also get stomatitis. Stomatitis is with the mouth. Mucocytosis. Mucocytosis happens in the stomach wall. Okay, and so what happens is these patients can get an inflammation in the stomach lining, which also contributes to them not wanting to eat, okay, and nausea and vomiting. Now, we would imagine that cancer attacks the immune system, okay, so we would imagine that would attack blood cells, okay, and so these patients overall will have anemias, leukopenias, and thrombocytopenias, okay. So here I broke down what they are, these topics. So anemia is a deficiency in red blood cells, which we know. Leukopenia is a decrease in white blood cells, okay? So if a patient has a decrease in white blood cells, what are they gonna be susceptible to? Infections, very good. So keep in mind that sometimes cancer patients can also have secondary infections, okay, because of that. Thrombocytopenia, if they have a decrease in platelets, that's going to increase their bleeding, and so that also has to be controlled, okay, if that occurs. And then other effects, so hair loss. So with hair loss, usually comes from the treatment and also the mucocytosis that can happen to it too. So this is what happens. We know that chemotherapy, for example, attacks the cancer, okay, which is rapidly dividing. So the goal of chemotherapy is to attack this rapidly dividing cancer. Well, it's also gonna attack other rapidly dividing cells along with it. That's the issue. And so the two top rapidly dividing cells in the body are epithelium and blood, okay? So if you don't know that, you should know it. The two rapidly dividing cells in the body are epithelial cells and blood cells. So when these patients that undergo chemotherapy, they're going to have their immune systems weaken because that chemotherapy, unfortunately, are attacking their blood cells. The chemotherapy will also attack epithelial cells, which is why they would have the hair loss, as well as sometimes having the lining of the stomach being torn apart, as well as sometimes having skin lesions, okay, because it attacks the epithelium inside and out. And the last piece of information here is that not in all cases of cancer, but sometimes some cases of cancer can lead patients into endocrine disorders, okay? So sometimes they can have what are called paraneoplastic syndromes, meaning that they can lead to Cushing syndrome, they can have hypercalcemia because the hormone levels are just, you know, be off because of the cancer. And the last slide here is cancer therapy. So cancer therapy, the most common treatment types we know already, surgery, radiation, chemo, drug therapy, okay, we know those, and sometimes they are combined, okay, depending on the cancer and how aggressive they have to get with the treatment. And then we do have emergent therapies, immunotherapy, which is basically boosting the patient's immune system, okay, to hopefully attack the cancer. Target molecular therapies are used to target the tumor itself, just one area in that tumor. And then stem cell transplant, we've heard of, and we know that that's definitely used for patients that have leukemias, okay? And so we'll talk about that in more detail next week. And I'm done. Wow, we're done early. Okay. Don't go anywhere. Really quick, I'm just going to write a quick little outline summary to get ready for the test next week. And I'm going to try to put this right in the view of the camera. Examples, terms, examples. And the reason why I'm stressing examples is because, as you notice throughout lecture, I always give tons of examples. And the reason why is because our test questions are going to be, you know, example-based or case-based or scenario-based. So it is important to not only understand the term, because we're trying to get away from questions like, what is this, what is that, but just understand like an example with it, okay? So for chapter one, that chapter we know is just basically terms, examples that I gave you. Chapter four, pretty much the same thing with terms and examples. However, just make sure you guys remember to review all of your pictures that you have. And with the pictures, I want you to memorize the pictures. And I can have questions like, okay, what is this picture? Okay, what is, you know, is it gas gangrene or is it, you know, whatever. Or I can have the picture and have some information behind that picture, okay, that topic. So just make sure you go over both parts of it. So please review the outlines on necrosis that you guys did, okay? Remember, go on Blackboard or the doc sharing. I do have it open, and it's open for everyone in the class to look at those outlines. I'm actually going to review those outlines, and I'm going to take questions directly from the outlines that you guys provided, okay? So I'm going to make test questions from that. And chapter 7, we have terms and examples, and then the tables that I went over, showed you guys, okay? And so just make sure you go over pretty much all the information in 7. Okay. Does anyone have any particular questions? Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. No, I thought something spilled. Oh.
Do you want us to sign out?
No, you don't have to sign out. Okay, have a good evening. I'm going to take you. Oh, yeah.